Hello, this is the RPG Chick, and welcome back to my Let's Play of Torment, Tides of Numenera. We're about to cross the Bridge of Cybermancy. Well, that's what I decided to call it.
In an instant.
Yeah, no big thing. So as you recall, last episode we came across a set of giggling dice, which really couldn't do much with. We broke off something of one of these alien hand bramble things and got a mace out of it. Pretty cool. We touched this giant obelisk thing with our crystal shard and upgraded it as a weapon. And we got a cool object out of this blob. Yeah, so here's an upgraded weapon. Infused crystalline shard as opposed to just crystalline shard. Here's the eight-fingered mace we got from the brambles. And what did we pull out? We had spray flesh already. Everything is like as strange as something else. That's the next thing. Oh, we got a cipher. A fresh vapor cipher out of this five uses. Pretty cool. So that was last episode. It was very interesting. Cobalt petals fold over a short metal stem. Calcified minerals holds the ancient weapon closed. Okay, so we can interact with this thing. Before we interact with anything...
Go.
Wait. Oh, I remember these guys. This was like an early demo or a video of the game. This might turn into a battle. I try to avoid it though. Qorro. I guess that's the leader of whoever these people are. As you step onto what looks like the back of an enormous construct, four strangers approach you. In the lead is a wiry man with parallel scars running from cheek to collarbone on the left side of his face. He gives you a welcoming smile, pulling on gray gloves embedded with pulsing lights. He's about to say something to you when he notices Calistage. He thinks, she's the star, or she came out of it. But what does Cal have to do with this? Cal, I thought you'd sworn off trawling the reef. Found anything tasty? His eyes travel up and down both you and Allegern. Well, I beg your pardon. Calistage says, odds and ends, Qorro. Nothing that would interest you, I'm sure. Her words are calm, but she has gone quite still. She thinks, what is he doing here? He has something up his sleeve, I know it. Let's just let them talk. See what happens. Kuro's hand curls into a fist at his side. I was wondering specifically if you had seen a falling star that landed near here not long ago. I've seen nothing of the sort, dear Qorro. Her lips close thinly. What about your friends? He turns to you. I know most of the traff that scavenges the reef these days. It's a rare pleasure to see a new face. Nice scars. How did you get them? Two things are more dangerous than death in this world, he says, his smile widening. Asking impolite questions of strangers, and playing with Numenera you don't fully understand. My error is in the latter category, and I've grown more careful since. Okay. He doesn't like questions. Where did the star land? Well, if I knew that, I wouldn't be reduced to harassing noble travelers. I never saw it, you see. My employer did, and thought, who is the most trustworthy team I can send at a moment's notice? He winks. Luckily, they were on another assignment. We were interested, and weren't too drunk yet, so... What interests you? Well, that's a stupid question, because it's for their employer. Their employer has the interest. I don't really want to answer his questions yet, one way or the other. So, at the risk of asking another rude question, what are those gloves for? unwelcome but anticipated complications. He does not elaborate. He does so love his ambushes. Calistas whispers in your ear again, even though her mouth is closed and she isn't looking at you. He didn't have the gloves when I knew him last, but I'd wager they're connected to devices in the area. So, Qorro says, apparently unaware of Calistas' interruption. The star. Have you seen it? Deception. Will this work, deception? Do I have anything with this? I'll be honest with you. I saw the star, but don't know where it landed. Success. Okay, now I'm not completely sure. When we see the check mark, I'm not sure if that always means success. I mean, so far, it has. Qorro studies you for a long moment before sighing. All right, he says. Well, do let us know if you spot anything of interest. I'd like to say we pay for the privilege, but if we were rich, we wouldn't be down here, would we? So he's thinking, if she's not telling the truth, then she's a fantastic liar. Guess I was wrong. We gained 25 experience. Are they leaving? Okay. I figured they'd go back the way they came. Now, it's interesting. I think this was in a video that, like, was posted, like, over a year ago. They got in a battle with these guys, so I just avoided that battle. And that's one of the great things about, well, both Torment games, I suppose. It's not a lot of fighting, and you can talk your way out of things. It's like a dialogue contest instead of a, you know, contest of might. Nice thinking, kid, Allegern says. That would have been a fiasco. You figured out why they were here, right? He thinks, I knew I couldn't trust Calistas. This is the last time I make that mistake. I'm afraid if I ask him this, that's going to tip off to the fact that I can read his mind. Maybe. I don't know. They saw me fall from the sky and came to investigate, obviously. Oh, sure. And they just had that ambush ready to go at the same time we were leaving. No, kid. Calistas sold us out.
Okay.
Excuse me? Are you suggesting I had something to do with Qorro's plans? She thinks, oh, I cannot abide his rabid paranoia a moment longer. Are you suggesting you didn't? An old friend of yours just happens to be waiting for us, armed and outnumbering us, as we return from the greatest find the reef has seen in years? It's too convenient for me. Too convenient by far. These two aren't really going to get along for much longer, are they? I'm pretty sure at one point I'm going to have to decide who I want in my party. Leaning towards Calistas at this point. Allegrin's kind of a jerk, sorry. I don't trust Calistas much either. But, I mean, she has her own ambitions for us. But that doesn't necessarily mean she means us harm. He is at least partly convinced that we're the fallen god, whatever it is, and he's not happy about that. Calistas says, of all the idiotic paranoid delusions, you really believe this, don't you? You really believe I'd use a half-wit like Qorro to stab you in the back rather than do it myself. You see, kid? She'll stab you in the back. First chance he gets, most likely in your sleep. He throws up a hand, forestalling Calistas' retort. Look, I don't care. Fact is, I can't trust you anymore. And I wonder why I ever did. This is the last we travel together. I've got enough to worry about without having to watch my back 28 hours a day. He turns to you. You coming, kid? Or what? Okay, I knew at some point we'd have to choose between them, like I just said, but I didn't expect it to happen right now. But maybe I can talk them out of it, right? Allegern, I really don't think she was trying to betray us. He snorts bitter laughter. I do. You haven't seen 1/10 of her depths, not 1/20. She's a backstabbing bitch. Mark my words. You're insufferable to the end, Allegern. Looking for the worst in this situation is the only way you know to see. Do you know how long I've carried your pain for you? How much I've had to turn away from your judgmental stares? But you're right. I've had enough. She turns to you. Child, I am happy to guide you, but I will not walk another step with this paranoid buffoon. Finally, something we agree on, he growls. Kid, she'll chop off your head and spit down your throat. I've heard ruder variations of that. I'll get you where you need to go and let you sleep at night to boot. It's up to you. Why can't I travel with both of you? Can't you just work it out? Callistus bursts out laughing. My dear girl, we have been working it out. Allegern's petulance, his obstinacy in the face of fact, drive me away every day. He might be strong, but he's also thick. I dare you to try traveling with him and see how long you endure. Not as long as I have, I'll wager. Allegern's face darkens under her accusations, but he manages a pained smile. As if you're doing me a favor by staying with me? Do you think I don't see your true self in all these echoes around you? That's you, Callistus. Every facet of it. Your vivisectionist heart hasn't changed, just the way you present it. I thought I could help you, but... Drink for the throat. I'd rather travel with Callistus. Allegern says, well, right, well, if you want me, and she doesn't sell you for parts, you can find me in the underbelly. But not with her, mind you. He thinks, she'll sell you for parts first chance she... Forget it. It's her choice, not my problem. I'll let you know what you've missed, Allegern. I'm sure you won't be... Missed, that is. She links her arm possessively into yours. Let's go, child. We have a world to conquer. Damn. Now that you've dealt with Qorro and his goons, you can continue on to the city of Sagus Cliffs. To reach the city, cross the bridge at the north end of the platform. Don't worry, I know how to look around, thank you. Okay. Yeah, let's interact with this thing.
Yes.
Yes. This is pretty interesting. I had no idea we'd be splitting up so quickly. I guess we're going to run into him later, or we can search him out later. Depending on what happens with Callistus, right? A lambent green fluid drips from the end... Okay, that's a typo. From the end of the device's nozzle, and hisses angrily on the metal surface beneath. Okay, some kind of acid or something. Without any antagonist to aim it towards, this device doesn't have any obvious purpose. Okay, we could have used that in the battle. But there was no battle, so... A spherical head hangs loosely from this stanchion. A single metal fiber holds it in place. I want to interact with all this stuff. Are you kidding me? Right, that's part of that.
Of course.
We didn't look at this? Oh. There was a shallow depression in the surface here, like many others scattered around the construct. Unlike the others, energy still pulses across this one at random intervals. A slight yet implacable sense of unease emanates with each wave of energy. There was a loose lens at the center of the depression. You think you could redirect the psychic effects to somewhere more useful, but it'll be tricky to get to it in between the energy pulses. A slight... Really, a sense of unease. Without any antagonist to aim it towards the device doesn't serve any obvious purpose. Too bad, we can use this stuff all in a fight. I kind of want to see what that would be like. A sickly green crust scabs over numerous cracks and divots in this turret. Well, if we weren't just 15 minutes, I'd end it now, just to, you know, round out the, whatever the, was it, Reef of Fallen Worlds? But yeah, we're gonna continue into Sagus Cliffs. Oh, Circus Minor. Okay, guys.
It is done.
Let's go to the circus. I might get some gold tied after a while. We seek the Order of Truth, so we must first reach Government Square. The easiest way is via the staircase by the old clock. Can I talk to her more? Calistes raises an eyebrow and waits. Can you tell me about Qorro? He's a knave and a blackguard and clever when it comes to Numenera. Nothing close to myself, of course. Where we are right now? She takes a quick look around as if sizing up your surroundings. He's tried to kill us, hasn't he? She shakes her head. Not necessarily. He's a dangerous fool and we're well to be rid of him. But we didn't actually fight him. He didn't try to kill us. How are you holding up? You have your charms, and they're a fair few more than most. I suppose I could say I enjoy your company, but we're beyond such trivial panderings, of course. Right. You know, the questions I've already asked her. Twin creatures of a type you've never seen flank a central orb, their cultural significance lost on you. It's like some kind of worms or something.
Allow me.
What's going on over here? Yin the Overseer and spectators. Unmoved woman. Okay, we'll check out all this. As you will. This woman stands in the back of the crowd, arms crossed and eyes cool, as she watches the slow execution. Oh, it's an execution. Unlike the others, she's also watching the people in the crowd. She shakes her head. Depressing. What exactly is happening here? Another in a long series of pointless executions. She points to the man with the rope of flesh coming out of his mouth. What? There's a rope of flesh coming out of his mouth. The poor bastard they're killing is put into a trance that makes him talk a lot of nonsense and spew that pink stuff. Eventually it crushes the life out of him and the big guy eats him. Disgusting. She thinks, I feel like someone should do something. Why is everyone just watching? I love that I can read people's minds like this. Why is everyone watching this? It's what passes for entertainment in this town. People like to watch each other suffer. Takes their minds off their own suffering, I guess. That's not why I'm here, though. I just got sucked in. She thinks, I want to stop it, I guess. But what can I do? Farewell. Yeah, sure. Spectator. A hideous sight, and yet I cannot look away. Cool, he's got a fin. Tiber? Let's talk to the named ones last. Excited man. This man watches the execution with fevered eyes. He shakes his fist. Traitor! Traitor to the city! As you approach him, he gives you a savage grin. Nothing better than seeing a traitor die, aye? Die, aye? What exactly is happening here? Justice. The Sagus Cliffs way. He jerks a thumb at the dais. We make traitors and murderers spill their guts, then strangle them with them. We also force them to speak their nightmares to scare other criminals into going straight. He laughs. And if that doesn't do it, then knowing that the devourer of wrongs is going to eat your body after you die will. Makes me sick just thinking about it. He thinks he deserves it for betraying the greatest city in the world. Why is everybody watching this? To see justice done. He thumps his chest. If somebody hurts my city, I want to see them hurt twice as bad. And getting crushed to death by your own words is as bad as it gets. Long live Sega's cliffs. The spectator. Shh, I'm trying to listen. Shh, I'm listening to reason. How about the spectator? If you ask me, the victim's speaking nonsense. Delusions of a dying mind, nothing more. Who's this? Oh, traveler. Horrified man. This man stares at the execution in utter horror. He cannot look away. No crime deserves such a punishment. How can this be allowed? What's happening here? A waking nightmare, though they call it an execution. He shudders. The unfortunate victim is put into a trance that forces him to speak his nightmares. His words spill out of him as a rope of flesh, which is wrapped around his body until it crushes him to death. He shakes his head, and the indignity doesn't end when the poor wretch finally dies, for then the devourer of wrongs eats his flesh. He thinks, it's not just, but what can be done? Everyone considers it tradition. Why is everybody watching this? They're animals. They find pleasure in cruelty. Farewell. Intrigued woman. Wait, let's... Levy? Okay, doesn't that someone named Levy? That's a title or something. A profession. This woman listens intently to the ravings of the man on the nearby dais. Hanging on every word, she gives you a hesitant smile. Can you understand it? I know he is speaking great wisdom. If only I could decipher it. What's happening here? An execution. She gestures toward the man on the dais. They put the condemned into a trance, and he speaks of the wondrous things he sees. His words become tendrils of corrupted flesh, which are wrapped around his body until they crush him to death. Then the devourer of wrongs eats him. She thinks, I think I nearly understood that last one. Why is everybody watching this? She shudders. Most are only thrill-seekers and the morbidly curious, but some of us gather to hear the words of the condemned. They are said to contain the most sublime truths, for they are born from dreams of death. We listen and try to understand their meaning. Stay true, friend. Huh. Let's talk to this Levy. This man is large and broad-shouldered, and his steel armor is painted in the silver and indigo colors of Sega's cliffs. He seems to be an ordinary soldier or constable of the city. Too ordinary, perhaps. As you scan his face, you see that his features are plain, forgettable, almost generic. Not only that, his eyes are a little too large, his smile too firmly fixed upon his face. He may look human, but his mind feels like a complete blank. I think he's a construct of some kind. Are you with the City Watch? The soldier peers at you, smile never leaving his face. You must be a stranger to this city. Perhaps from one of the Autochthonous tribes along the frontier? Allow me to welcome you to Sega's Cliffs, visitor. He speaks the final word like a title, almost an honorific. I am a Levy. You may rely upon me, and others like me, for protection and assistance, at the discretion of the Council and the slave families. What's happening here? An execution for treason, ordered by acclamation of the Council. The condemned man is guilty of selling state secrets to a foreign power. You call yourself a Levy. What does that mean? Every citizen is required to raise a levy for the protection of the city. In times of war or strife, citizens are sometimes called upon to raise additional levies, but this has not been required since a dread destroyer crossed the northern frontier 34 years ago. What? A dread destroyer? Examine him. If you saw the face of this man on the streets of the city, you wouldn't glance at him twice. His features are utterly ordinary and forgettable. Not too ugly, not too handsome. It is indeed like he is an average of many thousands of men, their idiosyncrasies and imperfections merged into a bland middle ground. The exceptions, of course, are the eyes, which are just a bit too large for the face, and a fixed, ever-present smile. Taken together, the man's features give you a vague sense of disease. Who are the council and slave families? Do they govern a city? Indeed so. Each slave family sends one representative, usually the head of the family, to sit on the council. We are required to follow their commands. Levies are raised by citizens? Yes, a year of life is taken from a citizen. The lost year is used to create a levy. Wow, really? That's amazing. He pauses ever so briefly, though his smile remains fixed in place. That is why our lifespans are precisely 1 year long. When our spans are up, we degrade into our component matter. What the hell? So it is a kind of construct using energy from a citizen or a group of citizens. If you're curious about the process, I have been instructed to direct you to the Order of Truth, where you may observe the machine that is our parent. What? How much time do you have left before you degrade into your component matter? I mean, personally, I'm guessing. I have only existed for 14 days, so by the standard calendar, I have 299 remaining, unless I am killed in the line of duty. What? That's crazy. A year is removed from a citizen's lifespan and used to create one of us. Anyone who wishes to become a citizen of Sagus Cliffs must make this sacrifice. Interesting. So to become a citizen, you have to do this. I'm not going to ask to go up on the platform yet. I don't think we can, but I do want to talk to this guy in the back first. I'm guessing that this levy is going to say the same thing. Let me just guess. Let me just check. I mean, this armored levy is almost a mirror image of his comrade who stands on the other side of the execution platform. You sense that something about them is subtly different, but at first glance you can't quite determine what it is. He nods and greets you in a remarkably similar voice. Hello, visitor. The condemned man was found guilty of selling state secrets to a foreign power. 4 months, 7 days he has left. Why do all levies look the same? This is how we emerge from the machine, but we aren't truly the same. Citizens can always recognize the levies they raised, and some can tell us apart by looking closely. Yeah, let's look closely then. Oh, I gain experience. A little bit. The face of this levy is nearly identical to his comrade on the other side of the execution platform. If they're different, the variations are extremely subtle and random. A slight difference in the shape of the ears, perhaps, or a barely discernible quirk of the lips when he smiles, as he does constantly. Otherwise, the two men could be twins. Actually, they're even less distinguishable than twins. Huh. Farewell, visitor. Okay, so why is it taking so long? So let's talk to... I gotta, like, catch up with these walking people, but first let's talk to Tybeer. Someone said it's sad, but what can you do? Pacing the edges of the crowd is a paunchy old soldier with a swaggering stride. At the moment, however, his jauntiness seems overshadowed by worry, and he alternates between watching the execution and searching the crowd as if looking for a miracle. Then his eyes light on you. He thinks, I've never seen her face before. This might be just the break I need. What? I don't like that.
I say, you look like someone who believes in justice. How'd you like to help a poor soul, wrongfully condemned?
What kind of help do you need? I don't need anything. But my friend there on the platform is dying. The nightmares his executioners have induced in him spill from him with every word he speaks and wrap around him like a snake. He glances at the execution. I know there are but a few strands around him now, but in a few days' time, they'll choke the life out of him. I cannot imagine a more horrible way to die. This takes days? He pauses. Well, that's not true. I have an imagination that would shame a sailor. He leans in. You'll need to be swift and willing to hold justice above law. But there is a way to save him, if you will hear me out. You know what he's thinking? Because we don't know the man. We're somebody new. And if we knew him, we most probably would not want to help him if we did know him, giving us what he was thinking. Who are you? Captain Lanchon Tybeer, retired, he says with a little bow. Extremely retired. Once a soldier of fortune, now its plaything. He takes another look at Riss, but my story can wait. Saving Riss's life comes first. Why is your friend being executed? A misunderstanding, he says, waving a dismissive hand. Riss and I were hired to deliver some expensive brandy to an out-of-town buyer. He breathes a sigh, weighted with disgust and regret. Would you believe that the bottles were stuffed with state secrets? Riss was accused of selling information to the enemies of Sega's Cliffs. They called him a traitor. It was a travesty, he growls, his eyes blazing with righteous fury. The poor lad had no idea what was in there. He thinks, tragic. If he'd known, he might have escaped too. Then he wouldn't be in this mess. Okay. So, apparently he believes his friend is innocent, at least. But you did, right? Well, he says, studying the air over your shoulder. There's a place for talking about what I know and what I don't. This isn't that place. He clears his throat. If you were a part of this scheme, why aren't you up there with him? Luck? He says, shrugging. I was taking a piss when they came for him. Went through the back window and scampered up to the roof. He shakes his head. I watched poor Riss being led away from my hiding spot. Swore I'd get him free. I hope it's a promise I can keep. Why are you helping him? Yeah. A friendship is not reason enough, he declares. Then his shoulders sag, and he hangs his head. Actually, truth to tell, there's more to it than that. I'm partly to blame for him being up there, and guilt's a strong motivator, eh? Yeah, that was kind of a no-brainer question. What's your plan? A simple one, but it requires nerve. Listen, he lowers his voice. It would be nothing for someone of your noble demeanor to masquerade as a city official and ask the council clerk for an archive copy of an old stay of execution. Once you have it, I'll write out a fresh one and add Riss's name. Then we'll present it to the overseer there, and poor Riss will be set free. He spreads his hands. There you have it. A foolproof, risk-free plan. That sounds like an extremely risky plan. Nonsense, he says, waving a hand. It couldn't be simpler. Just be calm, confident, and wear a winning smile. And then he gives you a winning smile. Where do I find the council clerk? He'd be in the government square, of course. There's a podium outside the council tower. I can't think of a time he wasn't there. Would it be simpler to talk to the crowd at the execution? Convince them to rise up and free Riss? Tiber looks uneasy. Well, you're welcome to try, my friend, but leave me out of it. Sega's Crypt Clouds are notoriously bloodthirsty, and the execution officials are not known for their sense of humor. You might regret it later, and you'd be alone when you did. He thinks, too many unknowns in a scheme like that. Not enough escape routes. All right, I'll help you. Excellent. Then you will need a proper story and a badge of office. Fortunately, I have the first, and you can buy the second from Sangolin, the clothing merchant in Government Square. He folds his arms. Once you have a badge of office, you will tell the council clerk you are from the Judicial Oversight Committee, looking into corruption in the commutation of capital sentences. The stay you're asking for is that of a notorious gangster named Carl Cardin, who was mysteriously set free a few years ago. Right, so then we're going to change the name to Riss. When you get Carl's stay of execution, I'll make a copy with Riss's name on it, and you can give it to the overseer who will free him. You see? Simple. He rubs his hands together. Now, if you'll let me join you, I'd be happy to show you around the city and help you with all this, and whatever else you have going. What do you say? Thanks. I could use the help. It would be my pleasure, but let's hurry. There's not a moment to lose. Riss hasn't much time. He has days. I'm gonna cut it here. What does it all mean? Death of Riss and Riss? Wow. So next episode, we're gonna talk to... What are they doing to that poor man? We're gonna talk to Tiber. We're gonna talk to Yin, the Overseer. We're gonna talk to Riss and the Death of Riss and the Devourer of Wrongs. And then we'll continue. So thanks for watching, guys. See you next time, and enduring. Grow strong.